and sale of the Rock Hall estate. This advertisement gave them the names of the owners of the estate, and this proved to be the key to all the missing information.
When the Rock Hall estate was put up for auction, it was owned by Benjamin Harper and Thomas Nihal. It is clear that by 1784, it had been sold in two portions, part to Samuel Fort of Bennett's estate nearby, and part to Gabriel Ford, proprietor of Ridgeway, another neighboring plantation.
Ford, in his will of June 1787, incorporated 6 acres and the boiling house and distilling house into Ridgeway, and bequeathed the rest of the Rock Hall lands, 58 acres, to his grandson, Christopher Ford.
Ford's estate remained in the family for 31 years and was then sold by his children to an enterprising planter, Richard Matthew Smitten, who incorporated the Rock Hall lands into a new plantation called the Spring Farm. Smitten eventually overextended himself and died in 1835, leaving his 3 estates, Holders, Mangrove Pond, and Spring Farm, heavily in debt.
In 1836, the 3 plantations were sold up for debt by the Court of Chancery and were bought by the main mortgagee, Thomas Lee. In 1838, Lee sold Spring Farm to Joseph Bailey, who retained possession until 1842.
Joseph Bailey was the proprietor of the Rock Hall lands during 1840 to 41. The son of Francis Bailey, the proprietor of Ridgeway Estate, he was a man of many parts.
He was a planter, and he reached the rank of Lieutenant Colonel in the St. Peter Militia. He sat in the Assembly as an elected representative for St. Thomas in 1838-39. And he apparently managed the Ridgeway Estate from the time of his father's death in 1831 until he sold the estate in 1842. He was a printer, bookbinder, newspaper and almanac editor, and publisher.
He described himself as a sworn land surveyor and as a practical engineer who could install and repair all types of sugar machinery. He built and repaired organs, clocks, watches, and he gave public lectures on geometry and conducted experiments in chemistry.
Bailey may have decided to subdivide a portion of the Spring Farm estate for a combination of reasons. He may have become bored with the planting life by the early 1840s. He may also have been forced to abandon planting because he was clearly not succeeding at it. Both the estates that he managed were accumulating debt.
If therefore he intended to try another profession, he needed some working capital. He might have recognized that the marginal lands at Rock Hall could provide such capital if eager buyers with ready cash were available. The payment of the Elcock legacy to the Monk Wilton laborers in 1840 could, therefore, have provided a golden opportunity for Bailey both to accumulate some capital and to salvage something from his unsung investment in the Spring Farm estate.
Conclusive evidence that Bailey did subdivide the Rock Hall lands and that Monk Wilton laborers bought some of the land is provided by title deeds in the Barbados Department of Archives.
Two of these deeds in particular reveal transactions between Bailey and legatees. Alexander Worrell and his mother, Celia Clark, each bought an acre or thereabouts at £70 an acre from Bailey in November and December of 1840. 9 other deeds reveal sales of lots of land ranging from a quarter an acre to 3 acres in size from Joseph Bailey to other individuals. The information in these deeds, plus Ada Marshall's memory, enabled Maureen Arthur and myself to prepare a crude map of some of the original village lots. However, after the paper had been completed, surveyor Frank Gibbons, who has greatly assisted us in this research, discovered in a fellow surveyor's office a large collection of plans of Rock Hall village lots, some of them dating back to the 1840s. Unfortunately, Only a few of these plans were of the original lots, but many others were old enough and detailed enough to allow us to identify most, if not all, of the original lots. We could then, with Gibbon's technical assistance, considerably refine the map of the village by correcting the boundaries of the village and correcting as well some of the boundaries of the individual lots.
From this reconstruction, we can now see that there were probably 38 lots covering about 40 acres during the 1840s. 17 of these lots were owned and occupied by individuals who received shares of the Alcock legacy. And the other 21 proprietors were probably ex-slaves who had been attached either to Monk Wilton or to plantations in the vicinity of Rock Hall.
The lots were mainly 1 acre in size, and they were laid out in two main blocks on a north-south line. The front block ran from the glebe land on the south across Highway 1A to what is now known as Yarwood Road. The back block ran from Yarwood Road northward to the extended gully, which marks the southern boundary of what used to be the Lewis and Seniors plantations and what is now the Dunscombe plantation.
This additional information also gives us some valuable sidelights on the history of some of the lots. Corydon Headley's 1 acre lot, after two changes of ownership, was bought in 1870 by the St. Thomas Vestry and became the site of the almshouse, now the district hospital. Edward Lewis's 4 acre lot was broken up into at least 6 smaller lots by the 1880s. Even more striking, Robert Downes's 1 acre and a quarter was divided into 7 equal portions for his children by the 1870s. Therefore, there is clearly a history of fragmentation of the comparatively large lots which originally made up the village.
A glimpse of the status and activities of some of the residents is provided by the House of Assembly's investigation of the franchise qualification of 5 voters in the controversial election of 1849.
Many of the residents were Moravian, or at least some of them were married at Sharon. Others were Anglican. They baptized their children and were themselves buried at St. Thomas Parish Church. Many, if not most, of the residents were artisans, and their relatively high status was reflected in the quality of their houses, if not always in the quality of their land. Edward Carmichael was a carpenter and possessed one of the best lots. His acre was described as excellent, as good as any in Rock Hall. On the other hand, James Lynch, the schoolmaster, possessed 1/2 acre of rocky, indifferent front land. Prince William Jones and Edward Henry Lewis were the largest landowners, and not surprisingly, they were also artisans. Edward Lewis was a carpenter and owned 4 acres.
Joseph King, a superintendent of highways, had an acre of mainly rock and gully, but his house was probably the biggest and best in the village. The house was built partly of stone, had a foundation, a hip roof, was neatly plastered, and measured 35 by 11 feet. St. Michael Severe remarked in 1849 that he did not know anywhere a laborer's house as good as King's.
And finally, Marshall wanted to find out if the economic independence of the villagers of Rock Hall caused them to play a greater part in the politics of the day. The villagers' participation in the political process was mainly the work of Samuel Jackman Prescott, editor of The Liberal and founder leader of a loose coalition, the Liberal Party. From the early 1840s, Prescott had campaigned for a popular extension of the franchise.
The failure of Prescott's first Franchise Reform Association to secure its objectives may have turned his attention to the possibilities of a campaign of voters' registration.
The prime targets of his activity were naturally the small property owners in St. Michael and St. Thomas, because their possession of property, if it was worth at least £20 in annual value, would qualify them for the franchise. There was perhaps an additional reason why he directed his attention to the parish of St. Thomas. A bitter personal and political feud had developed between himself and Dr. James S. Bascom, a leader of the Conservative Party who had represented the parish of St. Thomas since 1820. The campaign of voter registration appears to have started in November 1848. Prescott's method was simple and direct. He sought out those residents in the free village who seemed to possess enough property to qualify for the franchise. Then he arranged for valuation of their property. When he was satisfied that value of the property met with the requirements, he put them on the voters' list. Prescott's activity greatly affected the campaign and the outcome of the 1849 election in St. Thomas. In the first place, the number of registered voters in the parish nearly doubled between 1847 and 1848, rising from 43 to 74. Secondly, some of these new voters joined with other voters to invite two of Prescott's supporters, Haynes Bailey and Joseph Yarwood, to contest the election for the two St. Thomas seats. These developments naturally upset the leaders of the Conservative Party. Bascom's membership of the Assembly and his political dominance of the parish were being effectively challenged for the first time. Moreover, the participation of the villagers in the election seemed to threaten an upset of the natural order of things.
The Conservatives therefore met fire with fire. They abused Prescott and the other Liberal leaders as lower radicals who were exploiting poor, deluded simpletons. And they alleged that a significant number of the new voters were not properly qualified to vote because they had not paid the road tax. The Liberal Party responded angrily to these attacks.
The result of the election was an impressive victory for the Liberals. Haynes Bailey topped the poll for the Liberal Party with 34 votes. And Bascom and Grant, the former members of the Assembly, came next with 33 votes each, and therefore faced the prospect of a by-election to fill the second seat. They challenged the validity of 12 votes cast for Haynes Bailey and Yarwood by laying a petition before the Assembly. 8 of these votes had been cast by Rockhall residents. The Assembly proceeded to investigate the qualifications of the 12 voters between late February and mid-March 1849. Eventually, it was decided that only James Lynch's vote was bad, and this had the effect of creating a three-way tie at the top of the poll. Prescott's party, the Liberals, captured both seats in an uncontested election. The voters of Rockhall had played a significant role in one election.
Most of our written history has dealt with large groups and institutions, with the plantations, the planter class, the sugar industry, slavery, laborers, immigrants and emigrants. Also too, much of this writing has been based on the consultation of a few major sources, like for instance, colonial office correspondence, blue books, assembly and legislative council minutes, and newspapers. The result of all this has been that large areas of our social history have not yet been written up fully, and therefore we know little about small institutions and groups which were dynamic factors in our historical development. Also too, we know very little about the lives and activities of the ordinary people whose labor has made Barbados the community that it is today. This study of a Barbadian village formed just 3 years after slave emancipation may therefore be regarded as significant for a number of reasons. First,
It attempts to make a contribution to that small body of literature on free villages in the Commonwealth Caribbean by showing that, contrary to the view of many historians, Barbados shared with other Commonwealth Caribbean territories the experience of free village formation. This development in Barbados was certainly far less spectacular than that in Guyana and in Jamaica. But the development did take place in Barbados. Already, four such villages have been identified in St. Thomas, and it is probable that more existed in other parishes. Secondly, this study attempts to reveal the range and value of available sources for research on village development and other aspects of social history. The search of deeds, wills, registers of baptism, marriage and death, and particularly surveyors' records and oral sources, will clearly yield abundant information for the writing as well as the revision of Caribbean social and economic history.
Finally, this study attempts to raise the visibility level of individual members of a neglected social group and of the group itself. This is an important point.
Too often, our historical literature creates the impression that slaves and their descendants were little more than statistics, a willing or unwilling labor force, creating little for themselves that was durable, even anonymous. The reality has always been different. Many slaves and their descendants were clearly sentient, striving individuals. And the creators of the Rock Hall Village are a sample of that reality about which we should be reminded.
They came treading in the hoof marks of the mule, passing the ancient bridge, the grave of pride, the sudden flight, the terror and the time. They came from the distant villages of the flood, planning from the middle air to the middle earth in the common hours of their nakedness. Twin bars of hunger mark their metal brow. Twin seasons mock them, parching drought and flood. Oh, long is the march of men, and long is the life, and wide is the span.